ശ്രീ ഗോപാലകൃഷ്ണ ഗാന്ധി, ഡയറക്ടർ അരുണ ബഹുഗുണ, ജോയിൻ്റ് ഡയറക്ടർ ശ്രീ എൻ ആർ കെ റെഡ്ഡി, അവർ ഓണേർഡ് ഗസ്റ്റ്സ് ഇൻക്ലൂഡിംഗ് ഫോമർ ഡയറക്ടേഴ്സ് ആൻഡ് എമിനൻറ്റ് സീനിയർ റിട്ടയർഡ് ഓഫീസേഴ്സ്, ഓഫീസേഴ്സ് ഫ്രം ദ തെലങ്കാന ആൻഡ് ആന്ധ്രപ്രദേശ് പോലീസ്, പാർട്ടിസിപ്പൻസ് ഓഫ് ദ പി ഒ പി സെമിനാർ, ഓഫീസർ ട്രെയിനീസ് ഓഫ് ദ 66th RR, the 2013 batch of the Indian Police Service, faculty of the National Police Academy, other officers present here, ladies and gentlemen, I welcome you all to the National Police Academy and to the 29th Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel Memorial Lecture. It's our honor to have with us Shri Gopalakrishna Gandhi, eminent administrator, diplomat and writer, to deliver this annual lecture. I request Director Aruna Bahuguna to welcome Shri Gopalakrishna Gandhi with a bouquet of flowers. It's my duty here to introduce the Sardar Patel Memorial Lecture Series and the speaker, Shri Gopalakrishna Gandhi. The Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel Memorial Lecture is a lecture series at the National Police Academy instituted by the Government of India in memory of Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel, the first Union Home Minister of India. The first memorial lecture was delivered by the eminent civil servant Shri B.K. Nehru, ICS, in the year 1984. Since then, the Academy has been inviting eminent persons to speak on topics of contemporary importance. We have had luminaries such as His Holiness the Dalai Lama, the then President and eminent scientist Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam, the former Advocate General of India Shri Soli Sarabji, and historian Ramchandra Guha deliver this lecture. In 2013, that is last year, we had the eminent social activist Aruna Roy speak in this forum. Over the years, the memorial lecture has emerged as one of the major events of the Academy's calendar. This year, we are very privileged to have Shri Gopalakrishna Gandhi as the speaker for the 29th Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel Memorial Lecture. Gopalakrishna Gandhi is an administrator by training and has been secretary to the Governor of Tamil Nadu, secretary to the Vice President of India, and secretary to the President of India. He was invited to set up as its first director the Nehru Center of the High Commission of India, London, which he headed for 4 years from 1992 to 1996. The center is a forum for Indo-British mutuality in culture, literary and academic fields. Gopalakrishna Gandhi has been India's High Commissioner to South Africa, India's High Commissioner to Sri Lanka, and Ambassador to Norway and Iceland. He was Governor of West Bengal during the years 2004 to 2009. He has authored a novel, Refuge, on the subject of Indian Tamil plantation laborers in Sri Lanka, a play in English titled Dara Shuko on the life of Emperor Shah Jahan's eldest son, and has compiled the Oxford India Gandhi Essential Writings, published by the OUP in 2007. The University of Natal, South Africa, conferred a Doctorate of Laws honoris causa on him in 1999, and the University of Peradeniya, Sri Lanka, a Doctorate of Letters honoris causa in 2001. Lectures given by him include the Alan Paton Memorial Lecture at Pietermaritzburg, South Africa. I'm sure that the audience is aware of the importance of Pietermaritzburg in the history of India as well as history of freedom in the world. He has delivered the Nehru Memorial Lecture in London, the Kamala Lecture in Calcutta, the Maulana Azad Memorial Lecture in New Delhi, the Ambedkar Memorial Lecture in New Delhi, and the Bernard Soysa Memorial Lecture, Colombo 2014. His lecture today is titled Jai Hind, the Story of Indian Pride. Ladies and gentlemen, Shri Gopalakrishna Gandhi.
Director of the National Police Academy, Shrimati Bahuguna, Dr. Vinod Kumar, Mr. Reddy, distinguished former directors of the Academy present here, officer trainees, officers, members of their families, and friends. I am deeply grateful to the Academy for giving me this opportunity. The opportunity is valuable in more ways than one, for it gives me a chance to speak at the venue, the site where a major arm of the Indian state and a major asset of the Indian people begin and sharpen their skills and careers. Also because it gives me an opportunity to pay tribute on the eve of his birth anniversary to Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel. I would like to imagine an astral or cosmic scene and share it with you. There was on the 15th of August 1947 an arresting cosmonomy or cosmology on the Indian skies. It is a cliche to speak of people in terms of the sun and the moon, but if you bear for that moment of depiction a cliche, I would like to say that there was on that day, on the 15th of August 1947, despite the great trauma of the partition and the pain and the tragedy of partition, something which the Hindi word umang describes. There was an umang in the air. And there was on the skies the great solar presence of Mahatma Gandhi, though he was on that particular day not in Delhi but in Kolkata. He was like the sun. He was a daylight phenomenon. But then after dusk, as the sun sets and it becomes dark in the skies, we had a great luminous presence, a lunar presence, if one may call it, of Nehru. Silvery, not unflawed, but very attractive, waxed and waned in his moods, as also in his luminosity. And there was far distant, a very strong and powerful red planet. Red, not because of the ideology that he espoused, but because of the great energy, compressed energy that he had, Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel, in the shape of the Mars. And there was a meteor who appeared and disappeared, who dazzled and who also faded away, in Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose. At that time, many believed that he had not actually died, that he was still alive. But that apart, he was there too on the Indian skies. So he had the sun, the moon, the Mars, and this huge meteor called Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose. And there was a fifth asterism, namely the Earth, we ourselves, our country, India. So all these formed a kind of a galaxy. In the months that followed, within 7 months of that, Gandhi was gone. And a duumvirate of enormous potential between the Prime Minister and the Deputy Prime Minister came into being, between Nehru and Patel. Theirs had been a very difficult comradeship during the freedom struggle. And now it was a very difficult colleagueship, because they were from the same struggle, but they were two very different people. Nehru and Patel were of the same great family tree of the struggle, but they were two very markedly different people. And they differed from each other, and they made their differences quite well known. But what is important about the period 1947 to 1950, when Sardar Patel died so tragically and so traumatically for India, there was enormous amount of things that was done by that duumvirate. The accession of the princely states, four of them, to India, just by political persuasion and a certain amount of highly desirable arm twisting, was achieved at that time. No one but him could have done it. Why is it that no one but him could have done it? Because he knew the mind of the princely states of India. Sardar Patel knew how the mind of the princely states works. And he knew it with respect. He did not know it with contempt. He recognized the great skills of the great houses, the royal houses of India, whether they be in the Punjab or in Gujarat or in the south. He knew them for what they had done. So he had brought about the accession. He was home minister. He was also minister in charge of the princely states, and he brought about the accession. With, I must say, the great assistance of a hugely important civil servant, V.P. Menon. Accession apart, he also did a few things which are very important then and now. He introduced in the Lok Sabha the Preventive Detention Bill. Now he said, I am not doing this because I dislike communists or communism. I have nothing against the communist ideology, but a preventive detention measure is necessary because a few people want to misuse their liberties in order to imperil the liberties of the larger population of India, and that is not right in a democracy. So he brought in preventive detention. He also did something which was, strictly speaking, not necessary for a home minister, but even then he made it quite relevant to his office. In a letter which many people now know of, written by him in very late 1950 to the Prime Minister, he said, for the first time after centuries, and this is very important, he said, for the first time after centuries, we as a country have to be alert both on our northwestern and on our northeastern borders. And he spoke of China. And without saying that China has a certain ambition, he just said, we have to be alert both in terms of arrangements on the border for securing it, but also against possible threats to our internal security in the north and northeast, for which we must have patrolling and for which we must have intelligence units working there. So this was the kind of dimension that he gave to governance, and which the Prime Minister of India, Nehru, both of them being very different people, received with the greatest respect and interiorized, plus or minus, more minus perhaps in the matter of China than plus, but nonetheless interiorized. So we got in those 3.5 years an extraordinary example of how two persons who are ideologically separate can still work so well together. Netaji, extraordinary figure in Indian history. He, in many ways, reminded us of Shahid Bhagat Singh. I think there is no parallel to this, that years, decades after they have become part of history, in small villages and towns, we still see portraits in humble homes and establishments like shops, taxi stands, portraits of Shahid Bhagat Singh and Netaji Subhash Bose. They are not in power, The children are not in power. They are not in a position to threaten anybody. They are not in a position to invite attention to themselves. They are gone. And yet, Shahid Bhagat Singh and Netaji Subhash Bose are where they are. Extraordinary magnets of idealism and therefore of inspiration. I cannot think of any parallel like this anywhere. And there they were. Netaji, the more recent of the two. There are at that time, let me speak in the present tense for a moment. On the 15th of August 1947, there are people who think Netaji is going to come back. Perhaps wishful thinking. And Red Fort, the Lal Killa, the rampart of the Red Fort, is in the popular imagination completely identified with only one man, and that is Netaji. And look at the grace and the graciousness of those times. That Jawaharlal Nehru, who was the first Prime Minister, hailed as a Tarun Tapasvi, richly loved figure of India. He is on the ramparts. And apart from Gandhi, whom he does invoke as he would, the only other name he mentions and fulsomely and handsomely and famously and justifiably is Netaji. And Nehru says while unfurling the flag, and he spoke in Hindi, and I won't even try to recapture those words in exactly the way he put them, but something to this effect, ki aaj unko yahan hona chahiye tha. जिस झंडे को मैं आज इस ध्वज स्तंभ में ऊंचा कर रहा हूं वो उनके हाथ होना चाहिए था. That was the grace and graciousness of those times. And he ended that speech of his, Panditji did, as he did on every other year when he unfurled the national flag on the Red Fort, with the words Jai Hind. Now it is not very or sufficiently known that the expression Jai Hind came from Netaji. I'm sure most of you know it, but there are many who do not know it. There are these signatures of a nation, the national anthem, the national emblem, but there isn't in too many countries, I do not know them, maybe you will correct me, there isn't in too many countries what can be called a national greeting, and that is Jai Hind. And it came from Netaji, and it came like this. During discussions with colleagues in the INA, the history of the INA is something which you will know much better than I will. During his discussions with colleagues in the INA, Netaji said, should we not have a national greeting? This was in the early 40s. And it was suggested to him that, and it was suggested to him by his colleague, Abid Hassan. Important that we should remember the name of his colleague, Abid Hassan, who said, there is a very natural form of greeting among the regiments that I have heard, which is Jai Ram Ji Ki. So we should have something which sounds like that, which will be accepted by all the people of India. So he said, what about Jai Hindustan Ki? And Netaji said, that's a very good, very, very good suggestion, and I think it works, but it is a bit long, and we should have a sharper, crisper, two-syllabled national greeting. And he said, Jai Hindustan Ki should become Jai Hind. So it was Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose's gift to India, the national greeting. But I should also like to put on record today that the national anthem itself comes to us thanks to Netaji. It was in Germany when he had set up the Free India Center in 1941, that Netaji decided, and I'm using the word decided very consciously because that is what he did and that is how he was. He just decided that if we, who are setting up the Freedom Center of India outside India and are going to now start an Indian National Army, if we are going to move ahead, we should have a song which should also probably become the National Anthem of India. He decided that this will be the National Anthem of India, and he chose Rabindranath's Janaganamana. Both those we owe to Netaji. And both those were graciously acknowledged by Panditji as having come from Netaji. So we have Sardar Patel, who actually gave body and shape to Hind by his accession policy. And we have Netaji, who gave it the imprimatur in the shape of the national greeting. Now sometimes miscalled a slogan, Jai Hind, and the national anthem. I would like to say here that Sardar Patel and Netaji are names that draw confidence. Inke haath mein hamari khairiyat hai. Inke haath mein hum surakshit hain. But ye aaj hayat nahi hai. Ye hamari smriti mein hai. And yet, it is also true that there are those who have neglected both. For years and years, I think, the Indian state did not embrace the legacies of Netaji and Sardar Patel as it should have. Panditji, in his individual capacity, did not flinch from doing so. But successive avatars of the Indian state did not give either of them the attention, the respect they needed and deserved, not for themselves, but for India's greatness. So what happens? As time rolls on, those who felt that this neglect should be corrected now seek to correct it. And when they seek to correct it, there is a scoring of political marks, pluses and minuses. This is not good for India. This is not good for the Indian state. This is not good for the Indian people. It is a great pity that both the Sardar and Netaji were not given the due that they received, that they deserved, that they needed for the sake of India's greatness. But they do not deserve to become the subjects of political contestations today either. It would be, in my view, a grievous error to try to drive a wedge in the legacies of Nehru and Patel. It is the greatness of Sardar Patel, and nothing less than the greatness of that man, the greatness of that great man, that towards the end of his life, which was towards the end of his deputy prime ministership, in fact a few weeks before he took seriously ill and passed away, that he said in Indore, he said, Bapu has chosen Jawaharlal as his successor. He has announced that. And so Jawaharlal is my leader. And all of us have to accept that. And he told N.V. Gadgil, who was a minister in the same cabinet as he and very close to Sardar Patel, he said to N.V. Gadgil, whatever your differences be with Jawaharlal, never leave him. He is our leader. This was the greatness of that man. But this greatness of that man was not really recognized. And a cult grew up and was made to grow up, which excluded him. Not totally, because you can't do away with Sardar's image. On a plenary, the backdrops always had Sardar Patel there, Gandhi, Sardar Patel. But then, as more and more images got added to it, some images went into sepia, some went into slight overlaps, and Sardar was certainly one of them, as was Netaji. This is now sought to be corrected in ways that carries a counter danger, which is of converting truth into tactic. And that we have to be very careful about. I think we should know that if there is a possibility of Sardar Patel's name being misused, it is because Sardar Patel's name was disused. And we should know that if there is a possibility of counterfeiting the Sardar legacy, it is because the Sardar legacy was forfeited for many, many years. Both are wrong. Neglect is wrong. Co-option is wrong. Sardar is not affected by the neglect. He will not be affected by the co-option. But we should know the legacy to be what it is and for what it is worth. And that legacy can be crystallized into the two words, the two-syllabled national greeting which Netaji gave us, Jai Hind. I will take not too many more minutes of your time to say the following on India's pride, which is distilled into Jai Hind. India's pride and the story of India's pride, which clicked into Jai Hind, is a fascination. I'm not going into remote history because I'm not a historian. But as an observer of the recent tapestry of India's history, I would like to draw attention to the fact that there are five great pillars of India's pride. And of these, the first has to be the representation of Indian people. Now popularly called simplistically democracy. The tradition of Indians electing Indians to legislatures is pre-1947. And in fact, it is not even seen on Indian soil, but in Britain. In 1892, Dadabhai Nauroji, the grand old man of India, was elected from a constituency in London to the House of Commons. Dadabhai Nauroji. He was elected by three votes, by a majority of three votes. So Nauroji used to be called narrow majority. He had a narrow majority, but he had a wide stature. He was the first man of color, as they called him, to be in the British Parliament. And he was succeeded by two other Parsis, great community. Minuscular in size, but monumental in contribution. Bhavnagri and Saklatwala. 1, 2, 3. Elected to the British House of Commons, each from a different party, representing the diversity of Indian political options and option making. We did not vote for them. It is the London constituency that voted for them. But they were Indians who were being elected. And then in India, in 1919 and later, our democracy is surely one of the five pillars, and perhaps the first pillar, of India's pride. The second is soldiering. Our forge. It has to be the most attractive pillar of our five pillars of pride. And there again, it is not a post-1947 thing. In the First World War, It is an extraordinary thing for us to recall. We just celebrated a grand anniversary of that. That the number of Indians who went into war, into that first war, were not there because of an accident of colonial or imperial policy alone. Yes, of course, they were recruited, mobilized, deployed by the imperial power. But they were deployed, they were recruited and deployed by the imperial power because of what they were, because of the worth that they represented. If Patiala, Bikaner, if all these greats of Indian soldiering were where they were, it was because of what they were. Mesopotamia, sometimes not very delicately, but understandably, Mesopotamia in the war is sometimes called Mespot. That is where 6.75 lakh, 6.5 plus lakh Indian soldiers fought. In France, 1.38 lakh Indian soldiers. They were not digits alone. They were not just numbers. They carried with them the soldiering traditions of India, which goes back to the mutiny, of course, both sides and earlier. And that soldiering tradition, in the shape of Netaji, took a different dimension. There are many interpretations that can be given to the INA's role and whether such a thing was right or wrong. But that apart, they represented the soldiering traditions of India. And it has to be said today that it is that soldiering tradition which at this stage in our life keeps us together, of which 1971 was a great example. And that photograph of the three great Indian chiefs retrieving freedom for the people of Bangladesh and giving it to the freedom to the people of Bangladesh without an iota of Indian ambition in it is one of the great compositions of history. And we should also know that it was not just war for war's sake. In the great Treaty of Versailles, which followed the First War, I'm sure you've read the history of the First War much more than I have. But in the Treaty of Versailles, because of what India had done and India had stood for in terms of Indian soldiering power and soldiering grit, India was a signatory almost as if it was a separate state. That history had to record. And to lighten the mood of our discourse today, shall I say there is a third great pillar of Indian pride. And there is a connection again with the royal houses of India here. And I must confess, with the indulgence of Sardar Patel, and I'm sure he will tweak my ears in, shall I say, forgiveness for it, there is a Gujarati pride in me which makes me say this, that Prince Ranjit Singh Ji and Prince Duleep Singh Ji, what they did in the realm of cricket at that time contributed to India's pride. Ranjit, like Dadabhai Nauroji's narrow majority, Ranjit Singh used to be called Rangit Singh. That is what he was. And when he scored, it may have been Old Trafford, it may have been Australia, it may have been for the British team, for the English team, but there was something of Nawanagar and Jamnagar that was scoring that. And I must say, even today, cricket is one of the pillars of India's pride. Science is the other great pillar. I am zero knowledge about cricket. And my friend Ramachandra Guha would have told me, what are you talking about cricket in the NPA? All the officers there know what cricket is. You don't even know how to spell it. And you're calling it pride and all that and getting away trying to make your speech sound great and funny and witty and all that. He would be right. Equally so science. I have no science in me. But I know this, that science and technology, of which aviation is a part, whether it is J.R.D. Tata flying solo, or whether it is now Chandrayaan and Mangalyaan, it is Indian science. And it goes back to pre-independence times and is part of the pride of India. But just as there are five pillars of Indian pride, there are many more than five of Indian shames. And we cannot talk of India's pride without talking of India's shames. Because if we do, then we are deceiving ourselves and deceiving nobody else. And those shames can be identified by each of you. And I'm sure if we have a few minutes left for discussions, each of you may give us your alternative prides and shames for India. But let me give mine. I think, essentially, a society or a civilization is known by how it treats the following. How it treats, and this again may sound a post-colonial, post-modernist cliche, but still, cliches are overdone truths, right? They don't cease to be true, they just cease to be fresh. One of the shames of India or any other society is the way it treats its women. Let me not elaborate beyond saying that this shame is completely contained in that one name, Nirbhaya. But there are many gradations to that, and I need not elaborate. Maybe we will when we discuss things. The other way a society can be judged is the way it treats dissidents. And let us also recognize one thing. Thank God, the Indian woman at home is not a pushover. Thank God. But that is because very often the Indian woman at home is a dissident, constantly making her point from a position of vulnerability to another who is in a position of dominance. And very often, as a dissident, she wins. And thank God she wins. And when she wins, the beauty of the dissident woman at home is that she does not want to make her father, brother, husband, son look stupid. No. Quietly, in her own mind, she's happy that he has got the message. That's it. Dissident. So, how a society treats its women, how a society treats its dissidents, of whom many are women, is a sign of the maturation or the immaturation of that society. Third, and this is where we have a shame to contend with. A civilization can be also judged by how it treats its prisoners. By which I mean to include the unfortunate character who is in what is called a police lockup. How a prisoner and a person in a lockup is treated is a reflection of the decency of that state and society. We in India need to seriously introspect on why the so-called third degree and torture are almost an automatic part of the proceedings of punishment. Here, punishment is extracted from a possible future sentence brought forward and given in a stiff dose to a person who may well be found to be completely innocent. As you all know, the origins of the simple salute lie in this. Why a salute? I was told this. You know this much better than I do. That when a person salutes, he is making it clear that he is not bearing any arms, that he has no weapons. It is very difficult, except Rani of Jhansi, who could wield a sword with her one hand. It is very difficult for a person to use a weapon lethally with one hand. So you salute, no arms on me. But in a police thana, the hand is raised not to salute, but to slap, not just to slap, and I need not continue the sequence. When and as for as long as the Indian prisoner is the subject of unlawful brutality in the preliminary stages of an investigation, till such time, we will have a pillar of shame to contend with. I conclude with sharing a few thoughts on the final great pillar which I spoke of, or the first great pillar rather that I spoke of, which was democracy, and share with you a few thoughts on how that pillar can be turned round to show a very different side of it, or a facet of it, which is not always visible. And that is like this. We are the world's largest democracy. But there is such a thing called the quality of democracy as well. Numbers do not make democracy alone. There is something called the intrinsicality of democracy, the inner worth, the substance, the antarvastu of Prajatantra. And there we find democracy is under great challenge from the phenomenon called money. Can we be proud of democracy if we know that that democracy is being subverted from within by the use of money and that other M, manipulation through muscle power? I think if Netaji and Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel had been with us into the first 20, 30, 40 years of freedom, they would have returned money to its proper place, which is in savings and legitimate investments, and not allowed it to run amok in the playgrounds of Indian democracy. And that brings me to the final word. Democracy is not just about voting. It is about being empowered. None of us here is unfamiliar with rural India. Hum jab desh kehte hain, vatan kehte hain, to hum sirf ek geographical unity, jo Republic of India hai, usse hum matlab nahi rakhte hain. Desh, mulk, vatan, Tamil mein kehte hain ooru, wo zameen hai jahan ki hum aur hamare purvaj paida hue hain. Aur jab wo jo ghazab ki, kya ghazab ka gana hai, वतन से चिट्ठी आई है, वहाँ जो उस चिट्ठी में जो मिट्टी की बात होती है, इट इज़ नॉट जमहूरियत पाकिस्तान फॉर पाकिस्तानी और भारतवर्ष फॉर, इट इज़ द विलेज, इट इज़ हम ज़मीन, एंड देयर नॉट एवरीवन इज़ अ लैंड ओनर, द मेजॉरिटी आर लैंडलेस. वन ऑफ द two great achievements of the last 15 years were First was the RTI. I believe Aruna Roy was here last year. The right to information, RTI, is known in every village of India. Angrezi jante ho, na jante ho, RTI ka matlab bahut log janne lage hain. Hum RTI laga denge aap par. Dhyan se rahiye. Ye bahut badi baat hai. I am very proud of it. Dusra hai, Narega kehte hain. Usme Gandhi ji ke naam ko kyun joda, kyun nahi joda, ye main nahi janta hoon. Mujhe lagta hai ki jodne ki khaas koi zarurat nahi thi. क्योंकि अगर गांधी जी के नाम से जोड़ने कोई बुरा काम अच्छा होता है तो अच्छा है कि वो बुरा ही रहे. और अगर नरेगा खुद में बहुत बड़ा काम था तो उसमें गांधी जी के नाम को जोड़ने की कोई ज़रूरत नहीं थी. बहरहाल नरेगा इज़ एन एक्स्ट्रॉर्डिनरी थिंग दैट हैज़ बीन डन इन इंडिया फॉर द रूरल अनएम्प्लॉयड. एंड वल्लभ भाई पटेल विथ हिज नॉलेज, a good patidar's knowledge of the village of Karamsad and Bardoli, would have known what it means for a person who is not working, especially for a woman in the villages of India, to get an honorable wage. There are many defects in Narega, but to think of diluting Narega would be to weaken the pillars of India's pride. Friends, I started with a reference to Janaganamana. I shall take your leave with a reference to Janaganamana. All of us know that song. But we know an abbreviated edition of that song. And tomorrow at the University of Hyderabad, I'm going to have an occasion to speak on this a little more. We cannot have a long, 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 long national anthem. It has to be brief, clipped, amenable to martial music. So there are portions of Gurudev's great rendering which had to be kept out. Also, because a national anthem has to be about Umang. But a poet is not writing only for Umang. Poet writes about the whole spectrum of human emotions. And there, Gurudev has a portion in Janaganamana which is not part of our official anthem. And there he says, Ghor Timira Ghana Nibira Nishithe. This is part of Janaganamana, the original, full, unexpected Janaganamana. Ghor timira ghana nibira nishithe, peedito murchita deshe. Everybody knows this much of Sanskrit. This is Bangla, but actually it is Sanskrit. I don't think anybody will fail to recognize it. And if they do, I'll be happy later to translate it. Ghor timira ghana nibira nishithe, peedito murchita deshe. Dushopne, nightmares. Atamke, terror. Rukha korile anke snehamoi tumi mata. This is how he ended. And that Netaji chose for our national anthem with the stentorian greeting of Jai Hind.
With your permission, sir, we would like to throw open the forum for questions. There are staff with deployed with wireless mics. If anybody would like to raise a question, you can raise your hand. Kindly introduce yourself, sir, and then ask the question.
Good morning, sir. My name is Rajagopal. I was a former director in the academy. Please, sir. Sir, one point about the strengths. I think the greatest strength of our democracy is unity in diversity. And to that, the contribution of the All India Service has to be recognized at all times. I think one of the greatest strengths of Indian democracy has been the All India Service. And it was Sardar Patel who insisted that there should be an All India Service. I just want to visualize a situation, sir, from your viewpoint, as to what both Gandhiji and Rajaji would have thought if they had landed in India today. Thank you, sir.
Well, I'll sift the two, three observations, sir, which you have made. I completely agree that the unity and diversity of India is a matter of great pride. And in my mind, as I invoked the three great Parsis in the House of Commons and the great colleague of Netaji who coined Jai Hind, I was thinking precisely that unity in diversity. And I would recommend to all to Google, as I did in the context of this lecture, to Google Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel's February 1949 speech, when he talks about unity in diversity. Now, Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel did not believe in flourishes of speech. He did not try to embellish his speech. He just said what he wanted to say with the minimum of words. That is what he does in that speech on unity in diversity. I strongly recommend all of you read it and hear it on YouTube. It is available on Google. All India services, absolutely. And by that, really, he meant all India. Why was Sardar Patel regarded as a patron saint of these civil services, including the police services? He's regarded as a patron saint of India for two, three reasons. The foremost among them being that he did not, as a political boss, he did not believe that he knows India better than the officer. In fact, he did. He did know it better. But he did not want to convey that impression. He wanted the officer, including the police officer, to feel that Sardar Patel can learn something from the officer. He was a very good listener. Sardar Patel listened. And officers like to be heard, right? So patron saint. He heard them with respect. He took his own decision, but very often guided by the officer, but he heard them with respect because he knew that in India, which he has brought together, there is diversity, and it is diversity is the glue that is holding us together. But more than diversity, it is a kind of knowledge bank of different parts of India that they are bringing together. So he did not fail to acknowledge to V.P. Menon the credit that was due to him for assistance in the accession of Indian states. He also, what is often called integration of Indian states, better word in fact, integration. We should know this, that severely opposed to partition as he was, though he went along with the Congress resolution, in fact was part of the Congress resolution for partition, there were more people that the integration of the Indian states brought into the Republic of India than were lost by the partition of India. And more people were brought into the Republic of India, including the Muslims of India, than were lost by the partition of India to India. And in this he knew the role played by Diwans, by officers, who very often counseled the Maharajas to face the reality, or as they say these days, to smell the coffee and sign. On Gandhiji and Rajaji, sir, I think I know why you are asking me this question. I think I should resist the temptation of going into that in any great detail, except to say that both Gandhiji and Rajaji were very honest people, and they would have told us today to invoke the great past, but not to exploit it.
Sir, my name is Shankar Sen. I was a former director of the academy. I'm asking a question which has always baffled me also, and I'd like to know your views. Sardar Patel was senior in age to Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru. He had more greater following in the party. But despite that, why Gandhi chose Nehru as the leader and not as Sardar Patel? That is something issue which has always baffled me. What was the decision? I would like to know your views.
Sir, I can only give views, like I can guess. Gandhiji was a supreme realist. He loved Jawaharlal. He leaned on Sardar Patel. गांधी जी के लिए जवाहरलाल जी हम दम थे, लेकिन गांधी जी के लिए सरदार पटेल हम घर थे, हम मजाक भी थे. द वे दे लाफ टुगेदर, आई डोंट थिंक एनीबडी लाफ्ड. In 1932, when they were both in the Yeroda prison, one day Gandhiji told Sardar in a very dejected mood, he said it in Gujarati, I'll say it in English, "Someday we all have to die. We will all have to mount the four shoulders of our pallbearers one day." So Sardar Patel was working some. So he looked up and said, "First you take India to its freedom, after that you die, go wherever you want to." Practical man. And then in the same prison, one day Gandhiji received a hate letter. Now you see, today in the internet age, we all receive hate mail. Not all, but some of us, unfortunate few, receive a lot of hate mail. But hate mail is a very old genre. Anonymous hate mails are a speciality of India. Gandhiji once got such a jail letter in jail. So he wrote, he read it, then he told Sardar Patel, also in jail in the same cell, "Vallabh bhai, what should I do with this man? I have not hurt him. He hates me." Sardar Patel looked up and said, "Ask him to drink poison and die." This was Sardar Patel's no-nonsense mind. But why did Gandhiji not select Patel but Nehru? Many reasons. One is, Gandhiji's second unofficial second unofficial career, first was being ahimsa and truth. Second was being a doctor. He was what can be called, he himself called himself a physician quack. He knew the health of everybody around him. He knew which leader has asthma, which leader has heart attacks repeatedly, which leader is prone to diabetes. He knew their health as well as he knew their minds. If Sardar had been 20 years younger and fitter, he may well have chosen Sardar to lead the Congress after independence. But he knew Sardar's health was where it was. He knew Jawaharlal's health was where it was. And finally, I think he also knew that Sardar Patel can work under Jawaharlal because Sardar Patel is a great human being. Jawaharlal may not be able to work under Sardar Patel because he's a passionate human being. And he also knew that Jawaharlal was clicking with the youth of India in a way nobody else had clicked, other than Netaji. But Sardar and Netaji are both two people who could well have unfurled that flag and said Jai Hind.
I'm sorry, the front row is hogging this thing. My name is S.V.M. Tripathi. I retired as Director General of Central Reserve Police Force. But the most fond posting which I remember is that of an assistant director in the National Police Academy at Abu. The point I wanted to make was, you mentioned about one of the pillars of shame which we have, and that is torture in the custody of police as well as in the prisons. Because I've seen prisons also as a member of the UP Human Rights Commission for some time. This is a fact, this cannot be denied. We have to see as to what are the reasons. Do we do this, or does the police do this kind of a behavior under pressure from everybody, from the society, from the politicians, from the senior officers, from everybody? Nobody is willing to give any quarters. They talk about arrest of a rapist or of a murderer in 6 hours' time. The police, the newspapers say that 12 hours have elapsed and they have not been arrested. So the point I'm trying to say is, are we willing to give the kind of atmosphere, the kind of a working atmosphere to the police in which they do the right thing? We don't. We are not as of now. Now it's a vicious circle. They say that police should be first reformed and then we will give them more elbow room. And the police cannot be reformed because they expect the police to produce results in a straitjacket, more or less. So this is a dilemma which faces every honest policeman. Every honest policeman faces this. And we have to acknowledge this fact. How do we go about it? Are we first going to reform the police? Because nobody is willing to reform the police. Not the states, National Police Commission apart, the Supreme Court apart, but nobody is willing to do real reform where the police will work in a professional manner, in a legal manner, and will get nearer the public. You see, they don't want the police to get nearer the public. So my problem is, how do you go about it? Where are you? How do you solve this problem? This is a problem. And I'll be the first to acknowledge that this is a big problem. Because we are not working in a legal manner.
Thank you, sir. The very fact that you have asked this question makes me nurture the prayerful hope that we are on the way to where we should be. And I would really urge all the young officer trainees and officers from the police who are here today to reflect on the comments that have just been made and to resist pressure from outside if it comes to you to apply the third degree. But I would also say this, that while pressure does come from outside, particularly now from hyperventilating media for action, I must also say that police officers should not keep torture as an option at all, even if asked to do something that is illegal and violent. They should say, this is not an option. I have strength. I do not have perversity. Jail khane aur police ke thane, sudhar ke ghar ho ya na ho, saza ke ghar hote hain, lekin unko sitam ka ghar nahi banna chahiye. Ki bahut zaruri. Main chahta tha ki is jumle ke baad zara zor se taaliyan bajengi. Shukriya. Very happy to have a young hand go up. Not an ageist comment, it's a self-inflicted comment.
Thank you, sir. Good afternoon, sir. My name is Harsh Aditya Poddar. I'm born in the Maharashtra cadre. Sir, there is little doubt of the fact that integration of the princely states by Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel. The princely states by Sardar Patel is a matter of great pride to the story of Indian pride. So my question relates specifically to three states and what your take on that might be. Kashmir, Junagadh and Hyderabad. The legality of the position was clear. Once paramountcy lapsed, the states were independent to join either of the two unions or remain independent. But in this context, for all these three states, either army or police action, especially in case of Hyderabad, Operation Polo, as I remember, were launched. And do you think the way these three states were integrated into the Indian Union, that sort of gave credence and pride to the integration process? And what your view on that might be, sir? Thank you.
Thank you very much for that most challenging question. May I also say, do be seated. May I also say that I'm I'm so proud to hear a question like this, and would also urge you never to allow your interest in matters historical and academic to consider switching from your service to any other academic line. Please never leave your service. Retain your intellectual curiosity and rise to the highest pinnacles of your service. Kashmir, Junagadh, and Hyderabad. If you just see where they are located on the map of the subcontinent of India, you will know how diverse our evolution is. And I'm conscious of the fact that in this house, in this hall today, we have officers from other countries as well. So I'm speaking with a sense of great responsibility. All these three are part of the mosaic of India, which has grown out of the great turbulences, trials, and tribulations of time. A country is not just its land, is not just its land plus its people. A country is its land plus people with the inheritance of shared memories. Kashmir, Junagadh, and Hyderabad have their own memories, and memory is the result of experience. It is impossible for any chunk of the earth of the size and diversity of ours to have had the same level of political maturation or gone through the same stages of evolution. Each has its own memory system. So the reaction of an enlightened republic to each has to be what in techno-commerce terms is called customized. It has to be customized. No Indian map was as full of land and people as the Indian map became on the 26th of January 1950, when we became a republic. In its widest horizons under Ashoka, under the Mauryas, it was never as big as this. Ashoka has touched his finest nerve when he speaks of the borderers in his edicts. He speaks of the borderers. He does not say these borderers are not Indian or should be Indian. He is not talking of India. He's talking of his empire. And he's saying the people of the borderers, the borderers, have to be reached out. They have to understand us, and we have to understand them. These are not his exact words. He was not loquacious like I am. He was very terse like Sardar Patel. He wrote to be incised on stone, not to be recorded in digital tape. So he was very precise. But this is what he meant. We have to understand the minds of our borderers. So borderers need not necessarily be in the Sarhads of India. There are borderers within India. Hyderabad was such an example. But in the totality of India, Hindu majority Muslim ruler, Muslim majority Hindu ruler, Hindu majority Muslim, that mosaic, that flux, that complication which has come from the conquests and the ambitions and the natural forces of India's history, all had to be treated separately. Having said this, let me say that the best of administrators can make the worst of mistakes. And useless administrators can fluke success. Both happen. In the case of the 554 states becoming part of India, many things were done across the table, on paper, matter solved. But in these three instances, history was more adamant. And even today in Kashmir, we have issues which we have to contend with. But I think in the overall, there is no other way in which what was done could have been done. Perhaps anticipation might have helped, but in the overall, I think what was done was exactly how it should have been done. Which does not mean that the last word has been said. Certainly not, and certainly not in Kashmir. Maybe one other question from among the officer trainees, and then we should adjourn. Oh, yes. Sir. Am I overstepping?
Good morning, sir. My name is Waseem Akram. I am from Haryana cadre. Sir, I would like to know your views on another very good song which we are proud of, and this is part of our march past as well, Sare Jahan Se Acha. And deliberation on this song as well. During the time when the national song and national anthem, these things were decided. So whether it was also deliberated upon, and in the context of its controversial affiliations, the writer's controversial affiliations in present context which is seen right now. Please do reflect on that.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. What a wonderful question. I must say, before I answer your question, that it is such a joy to see the level of intellectual ferment in the officer trainees. When I was exactly in your position in 1968, it would not have occurred to me to ask such questions. I would not have plucked up the courage to ask such questions, though the speakers who came were far more in a far better position than I am to answer those questions. There's a huge advance. I am so full of pride. Now, Netaji considered Sare Jahan Se Acha, Vande Mataram, and Janaganamana, all three. Now, here is a man who was, it was wartime. He did not know how the war will end. He didn't know whether he will live or die, when India will become freedom, will get freedom. But he was putting all this in the agenda. He saw all this. He felt Sare Jahan Se Acha has a very strong chord. It rings a very strong chord. But the language being the language it is in, it will not have the same impact south of the Vindhyas. Janaganamana had very little non-Sanskrit in it. So Tamil Nadu may find it a bit difficult, but still there are many words which are common and they will understand it. Vande Mataram had been a great, great patriotic song, and it was. But Tagore himself told Netaji that it has issues, you better be very careful with Vande Mataram. It is a great song, but it may find resistance in India, and we want no resistance to a national song. I feel only India could have resolved the way this as it did. All countries have national anthems, but we have a national anthem and a national song, which is Vande Mataram. And it is a wonderful Indian solution to the problem. But in the process, Allama Iqbal has slipped out of our discourse. Sare Jahan Se Acha is an all-time song, and it is an all-time favorite. And it is, shall I put it this way, Janaganamana Rashtriya Gaan hai. Vande Mataram national song hai. Sare Jahan Se Acha hamesha Hindustan ka tarana rahega. Wo logon ke dil mein rahega. Aur usme ek aur main, jaise ki maine aapko kaha ki janagana man mein ghor timira ghana nibira nishite hai, wo dard ki awaaz hai. National anthem mein dard ki awaaz nahi honi chahiye. और वैसे भी संक्षिप्त होना चाहिए तो नहीं है वैसे ही सारे जहां से अच्छा आप सब गाइएगा और जब उसको पढ़िएगा तो गौर करिएगा हम सब ये दो तीन जुमले जानते हैं मजहब नहीं सिखाता हम सब जानते हैं बुलबुले हिंद के हम सब जानते हैं लेकिन मेरे जहन में सारे जहां से अच्छा जो है तराना उसका सबसे नाजुक अंश है इकबाल कोई महरम अपना नहीं जहां में इकबाल कोई महरम अपना नहीं जहां में मालूम क्या किसी को दर्दे निहां हमारा और ये जो हमारा है वो इकबाल किसी एक कौम को ख्याल में रख के नहीं कह रहा है मालूम क्या किसी को दर्दे निहां हमारा ये जो दर्द हो सकता है ये हिंदुस्तान की महिला का दर्द हो सकता है ये निर्भया का दर्द हो सकता है ये थाने में तकदीर का मारा बेचारा उसका दर्द हो सकता है. तो ये आप हमेशा याद रखिए कि सारे जहां से अच्छा इज नॉट ए ट्रायम्फलिस्ट सॉन्ग, इट इज द सॉन्ग ऑफ कॉन्शियस, और उसमें दर्द का उल्लेख है, और हम उसको जहन में रखें.
Thank you, sir. Respected Sri Gopal Krishna Gandhiji, former directors of the Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel National Police Academy, senior officers present here for the seminar, eminent guests from the city of Hyderabad and police officers, faculty and families, and officer trainees of the 66RR. Sir, this academy is named after Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel. While we all know many great things about Sardar Patel, but today, sir, you have exposed us to some of the dimensions of the great personality which makes us feel proud about him and his contribution to this nation, and probably about the very existence of the service, Indian Police Service, to which we all belong. Sir, your talk, I am sure, will make the officer trainees to imbibe the spirit to respect human rights and not do anything which may cause or bring shame to themselves or to this very nation. I thank you very much, sir, for taking out the time to come here and deliver the 29th Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel Memorial Lecture. I will now call upon everyone to have tea with us on the lawns outside. Jai Hind.
I request the director to give a memento on behalf of the academy as a token of respect as well as thanks. Thank you.